for our worship this morning, and we've gathered a not simply for worship, but to incorporate the sacrament of Holy Communion. All are welcome to share in the supper. And then, if you don't have to hurry away, please join us for tea and coffee across in the gathering place at the close of the service. A few notices. A reminder, mainly, of all the Holy Week services. But before we get there, just a reminder to elders, the Risen Find the Kirk session meeting this week on Wednesday at 7 o'clock in here, not in here, of course, in the hall, the lesser hall. And then on Thursday in the morning, those of you who can go, there is the service for Roma Keane at 10:30 for Bill. And David is dealing with that, thanks for that. Holy Week services, Monday, Thursday at 6:30 in here for our Monday, Thursday communion. Good Friday, there is the Meet and Mouth Churches Together Walk of Witness, beginning at St. Agatha's and finishing up in Leland High Street, and then coming here for a service at around about 1:30. Good Friday, there's an evening service in St. Kenneth's at 6:30 in Kenway. Easter Day, if you want to be an early bird, you have a couple of options. Leland Beach at 7:30 a.m, hosted by the Baptist Church, if you wish to be part of that. If you still want an early morning service, but not quite so early, you can always go over the border to Kenway Den for 8:30. And then back here for 11:30 for the service. A reminder too that the clocks go forward in the early hours of next Sunday morning, so if you want to be an early bird, you're really an early bird next Sunday. And lastly, just to say that Iona, our parish assistant, who has been on annual leave, is currently now on sick leave. So just to give you that for a point of information. In the Bible, not all starring roles are given to human beings. Given that God himself is clearly at the centre of Scripture, that is hardly a novel statement to make. Though, of course, God does make himself known to us most clearly in human form as the Lord Jesus. But today, on this Palm Sunday, we're going to consider the events of the first Palm Sunday through the eyes of the most famous non-human character, the donkey on which Jesus rode into Jerusalem. Now, you might well ask me, what could I possibly learn from a donkey? I hope that our worship today will persuade you that God can sometimes speak to us in surprising ways as we come before him in faith. Let us worship God, echoing the shouts of praise from that first Palm Sunday crowd. We sing the Palm Sunday hymn at 367, Hosanna, loud Hosanna, the little children sing, 367.
Thank you.
protection over them, that those who love your name may exult in you. Let us pray. Just as that first Palm Sunday crowd spread their cloaks on the road in your honour, Lord, so you honour those who take refuge in you and spread your protection over them. And so today, with those cries of Hosanna already resounding in our ears, we worship you as the God who protects his people as a mother hen protects her chicks, as the God who protects his people even when it seems as though danger is all around, as the God who protects his people when many today would seek to discredit us for our faith in you. The hymn writer of old put it well, Lord, O spread thy covering wings around till all our wandering cease, and at our Father's loved abode our souls arrive in peace. We ask that you would indeed cover this gathering and our lives in the world with your protection, this day and always. Father, we confess that sometimes, like that first Palm Sunday crowd, we have been quick to turn from offering our shouts of praise to crying, Crucify. Perhaps not always by what we say, but sometimes by what we do. As we prepare to walk with you through this holiest of weeks, Lord, forgive all that is past, even as we make our own confession in the silence of our hearts. Sisters and brothers, you are forgiven. Be at peace. Holy Spirit, move in us, we pray, as we move with the Palm Sunday procession and throughout this week. As we commit all these prayers to you, in your most holy name. Amen. In the hymn we sing now, we again join with the praise of the crowd as we celebrate all that Jesus came to do. The hymn as printed, come on and celebrate. We'll sing through twice.
Reading is taken from Luke chapter 19 verses 29 to 40. This can be found on page 79 going over to page 80 of the Pew Bible. When he had come near Bethphage and Bethany at the place called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of the disciples, saying, Go into the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, Why are you untying it? Just say this, The Lord needs it. So those who were sent departed and found it as he had told them. As they were untying the colt, its owner asked them, Why are you untying the colt? They said, The Lord needs it. Then they brought it to Jesus, and after throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus on it. As he rode along, people kept spreading their cloaks on the road. Now, as he was approaching the path down from the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to praise God joyfully with a loud voice for all the deeds of power that they had seen, saying, Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven. Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, Teacher, order your disciples to stop. He answered, I tell you, if these were silent, the stones would shout out. The word of God for the people of God. Amen.
As we come to take a fresh look at the Palm Sunday story through the eyes of the donkey, we join one of the crowd who urges us to come into the streets with me. The hymn is at 366.
Come into the streets with me, come to where the crowds will be. See a strange and gentle king on a donkey travelling. Come and follow my leader, come and follow my leader. Jesus Christ is riding by, come and follow my leader. Come into the streets with me, come to where the crowds will be. See a strange and gentle king on a donkey travelling. Come and follow my leader, come and follow my leader. Jesus Christ is riding by, come and follow my leader. Obey Jesus' instruction to go into the village ahead of them.
They might have preferred to remain at Jesus' side, to walk at their own pace, or perhaps, if they were the two disciples who had experienced the Mount of Transfiguration, to look for another Mount of Transfiguration experience with the Lord. But none of those options are open to them by Jesus. The command is simple yet profound. Go into the village ahead of you. As we often consider when it comes to the life of faith, moving in reverse is not really on the agenda, though sometimes we are encouraged to be still and know that the Lord is God. The village is ahead of the disciples. They haven't been there before, as far as we know, but they are called to look ahead and go into the village in order to do their master's bidding. What of you and me? Sometimes I might end a service with a dismissal like, go in peace. But it seems as though Jesus turns that on its head, and it is as though he starts with that exhortation, go in peace. And he says, as you go, you will discover the plans I have for you and the tasks that I have in mind for you to do. The two disciples then go on into the village, and there they meet the colt. As they and we meet him, it is worth pointing out that it is no accident that a colt is the animal chosen by Jesus. For in riding into Jerusalem on a colt, Jesus fulfills the prophecy of Zechariah. Rejoice greatly, O daughter Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter Jerusalem. Lo, your king comes to you, triumphant and victorious is he, humble and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. So the colt was destined to play a starring role in the Palm Sunday procession. But using our verse quoted earlier, what can we learn from him? Firstly, we read that this colt had never been ridden. Think of that for a moment. The reality is that the colt could only fulfill his purpose as he was ridden. I'm using a bit of artistic license here, but as I thought about this, I pictured the colt on the corner, or perhaps it was by the side of the road, but the corner worked for my title, minding his own business, chewing away at some grass, when all of a sudden the disciples came and led him away. And that intrigued me. I began to wonder if we are not a bit like that sometimes. We are content to live life as we are in our own strength, doing life as best we can. But if we continue to do that, to live life only in our strength, we will miss out on the purpose which God has for us. Those of you here in Leven may not know that prior to entering training for the ministry of Word and Sacrament, I had a job in the admin team at Waste Services in Stirling Council. When I accepted that job, I knew that I needed to succeed in that job to prove to myself and perhaps the church assessors that I was fit to enter training. Of course, there was much more to it than that, but at least partly both I and the church assessors felt that if I could make a success of the normal working world, that would help form me into a more rounded minister and human being. In due time, it became apparent that I really was called to the ministry and the right doors opened. But had I buried my head in the sand or stayed by the side of the road, so to speak, I would not have fulfilled the purpose which God had for my life. So I wonder, is there a purpose which God has for you, or for us as the church here, which we are waiting for him to reveal to us? Secondly, we read that the colt was tied up. That too got me thinking, for Jesus was quite clear in his instruction that the colt required to be untied. I wonder, are you, am I, is the church tied up? Spiritually speaking, do we need to ask the Holy Spirit to release us from ways of life or ways of being in order that we might fulfill our purpose. For instance, in the matter of worship, if we always say, that's not how we do things here, or we tried that and it didn't work, I hasten to add, I've never heard that since I started here, we will never know if God doesn't in fact want to reveal a way of worshipping which is meant for us now. That purpose will remain undiscovered. Or in the matter of outreach, if we always say people aren't interested anymore and never try to engage with them or invite them to experience faith for themselves in ways intelligible to them, we're tying ourselves down to a really insular model of church, which seems to me to be the very opposite of a church which heeds the Lord's call to go. Or even in the matter of what we actually believe about our faith, both as a congregation and as a national church. We've been tying ourselves in knots for years over what the church rather archaically calls the substance of the faith. Of course, as far as I can gather, nobody at General Assembly or anywhere else has ever actually defined what the substance of the faith is. And so if anybody watching online belongs to the relevant General Assembly Committee, feel free to be in touch with them. When I was preparing this week, I read that for the person who wants to be able to act proficiently in certain emergency outdoor situations, there are 21 knots which are essential to learn. And of course, there are situations in which knots are actually life-saving. But let us pray that God might untie us from all the wrong kinds of knots, releasing us from unhelpful ways of living or being in order that we might fulfill our purpose. Thirdly and finally, we read that the colt was brought to Jesus. Indeed, the colt only fulfilled his purpose when he was brought to Jesus, when he sat on it and rode on it into Jerusalem. In the same way, people today, and at every time since, all through history, only fulfill their purpose when they are brought to Jesus. There is a well-known story in the Gospels of a time when a group of friends did whatever it took to bring a paralyzed man to Jesus. One day Jesus was teaching, and Pharisees and teachers of the law were sitting there. They'd come from every village in Galilee and from Judea and Jerusalem. And the power of the Lord was with Jesus to heal the sick. Some men came carrying a paralyzed man on a mat and tried to take him into the house to lay before Jesus. When they could not find a way to do this because of the crowd, they went up on the roof and lowered him on his mat through the tiles into the middle of the crowd, right in front of Jesus. When Jesus saw their faith, he said, "Friend, your sins are forgiven." The friends in that passage had one simple aim: to do whatever it took to bring the paralyzed man to Jesus. Initially, they tried the conventional approach. They tried simply to take him into the house, but the crowd was so large that they did not succeed. So they thought outside the box. They made an opening in the roof and lowered the man right in to the presence of Jesus. I think we can use this parable, or this encounter, as a kind of parable for how the church needs to operate today. We have tried the conventional approach to bring people to Jesus, and for the vast majority of people, it doesn't work. And so, the question for us, how can we make an opening for people to experience Jesus in a meaningful way today? Jesus said, "Go into the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it here. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen." as we begin our celebration of the sacrament of communion, I invite you to stand as you're able, as we use the responses on the sheet, to dedicate our offering today. Please stand. Blessed are you, Lord, God of creation. Through your goodness we have our breath to offer, which earth has given and human hands have made. It will become for us the bread of life. Blessed are you, Lord, God of creation. Through your goodness we have this wine to offer, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become for us the cup of salvation. Blessed are you, Lord, God of creation. Through your goodness we have ourselves and this money to offer. We are fruit of the womb and formed by your love. We will become your people for the world. He was always the guest. In the homes of Peter and Jairus, Martha and Mary, Joanna and Susanna, he was always the guest. At the meal tables of the wealthy where he pled the case of the poor, he was always the guest. Upsetting polite company, befriending isolated people, welcoming the stranger, he was always the guest. But here, at this table, he is the host. Those who wish to serve him must first be served by him. Those who want to follow him must first be fed by him. Those who would wash his feet must first let him make them clean. For this is the table where God intends us to be nourished. This is the time when Christ can make us new. So come, you who hunger and thirst for a deeper faith, a better life, for a fairer world, Jesus Christ, who has sat at our table, now invites us to be guests at his. So come to this table, not because you must, but because you may. Not because you are strong, but because you are weak. Come not because any goodness of your own gives you a right to come, but because you need mercy and help. Come because you love the Lord a little, and would like to love him more. Come because he loved you and gave himself for you. Come and meet the risen Christ. For we are his body. It is Jesus, God incarnate, the risen Christ, who joins us together as a community of broken but hopeful believers, loving what he loved, living what he taught, and striving to be his faithful servants in our time and place. In this meal we remember Jesus, his promises, and the price he paid for who he was, what he said, and what he did. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. The communion hymn number 19, Ye Gates, lift up your heads on high, number 19.
Thank you.
tongues were turned by another set of believers for the sake of the same bread and wine and the same Saviour. Hear now the words that have slowed down the liturgy to become the sacred moment as the community held its breath, as bread was broken and wine poured in the name of the Saviour. For I received from the Lord, says Paul, that which I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." As the Lord Jesus, the same night on which he was betrayed, took bread, "I take these elements of bread. And of wine, to be set apart from all common uses to this one holy use and mystery. And as he gave thanks and blessed, let us draw near to God and offer him our prayers and thanksgivings, the responses on the sheet. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give you thanks and praise, O Lord our God, sustainer of the universe. At your command all things came to be, by your will the vast expanse of space, galaxies, suns, the planets in their courses, and this fragile earth, our island home, were all created and have their being. You brought forth the human race and blessed us with memory, reason, and skill. You made us the stewards of creation, but we turned against you and betrayed your trust. Yet your mercy is like a spring that never fails. You yourself in Christ your Son come to deliver us. You redeem us in love and pity. You create new heavens and a new earth, for the cry of distress is heard no more. Therefore we praise you, joining with the heavenly chorus, and with those in every generation who have looked to you in hope, to proclaim with them your glory in their unending gift. We say together, "Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." Gracious God, we recall the death of your Son, Jesus Christ. We proclaim his resurrection and ascension. And we look with expectation for his coming as Lord of all the nations. We who have been redeemed by him and made a new people by water and the Spirit, now bring you these gifts. Send your Holy Spirit upon us and upon this bread and wine, that we who eat and drink at this holy table may share the life of Christ our Lord. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon the whole earth, and bring in your new creation. Gather your church together from the ends of the earth into your kingdom, where peace and justice are revealed, that we, with all your people of every language, race, and nation, may share in the banquet you have promised. All this we pray through Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us in the family prayer of the church, in every age and place, to pray together, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen." According then to the holy institution, example, and command of our Lord Jesus Christ, and as a memorial of him we do this, who in the night when he was betrayed took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it. And said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same do so in memory of me. So take it, this is the body of Christ, which is broken for you. Do this remembering him. And this cup is the new covenant, which is sealed that the sins of the many might be forgiven. Drink of it, all of you. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. On the evening of that first Easter day, when the disciples were together behind locked doors for fear, Jesus came and stood among them. Peace be with you, he said. Then showing them his hands and side, the disciples were overjoyed, and Jesus said again, peace be with you. In the joyful presence of our risen Lord, let us offer to those about us a sign of the peace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we praise and salute you that on this day our Lord entered in triumph into the holy city of Jerusalem. And we pray that to give us grace that we may welcome and crown him our Lord and King, the evermore for his holy name's sake. Holy Lord Father Almighty, everlasting God, we thank you for your Son, Jesus, who fulfilled the prophetic words and entered the city of Jerusalem for us and all men. We praise you that he enters our world as Saviour and King and calls them to choose him. Amen.
Thank you. descend upon you and remain with you.